movement in circuits of the two antithetical metamorphosis of commodities, or the never-ceasing alteration of sale and purchase, is reflected in the restless currency of money, or in the function that money performs of a perpetuum mobile of circulation. But so soon as the series of metamorphosis is interrupted, so soon as sales are not supplemented by subsequent purchases, money ceases to be mobilized. It is transformed from mobile into immobile, from movable into immovable, from coin into money. Firstly, we should discuss what Marx means by money. Throughout the previous videos, I've used the term money to describe the commodity that we use to engage in exchange, mainly for the sake of making discussion and explanation easier. For Marx, however, money is a specific form of that commodity. We now understand that the commodity money, as a representation of value, circulates the commodity exchange process, expressing itself in the exchange value of commodities. However, when it stops circulating for whatever reason and becomes immobile, it thus becomes a store of value, value to be used at some other time. It's only in this form that it is truly money. This is Marx's distinction, the one between mobile and immobile. Money is the storage of value. The hoarder, therefore, sacrifices the lust of his flesh to the fetish of gold. When money is held by its owners, or hoarding as Marx calls it, it breaks the flow of commodity circulation. For a hoard of money to be formed, the seller of commodities simply doesn't purchase. They get richer by denying money its capacity to satisfy themselves, removing themselves from commodity consumption. If we understand that the circulation process is a process of social relations between people, and that money, in its ability to be exchanged for any commodity, is the embodiment of that social relation, we understand that money is a social power. But the hoarder becomes caught in a contradiction. To accumulate money, they must deny themselves access to this social power. It simply becomes latent power, or power in waiting. Hoarders become the victims of their own money fetishism, believing that the object of making money is the money itself. If we look at the pre-capitalist mercantile economic system of 17th century England, we can see that this is essentially how it functioned. Its economic policy was to restrict imports of commodities, and thus restricting the outflow of gold as payments, but to encourage exports, and thus the inflow of gold. While this is not how capitalism functions, Marx highlights how a certain aspect of hoarding is productive to capitalism. Because of the fact that value, price, quantity, and velocity in the circulation sphere fluctuate and change, the amount of money in circulation must be regulated. So a hoard provides flexibility by being able to hold or release money into circulation when needed. This is the role of central banks and federal reserves. So a hoard is not simply separate from circulation, but it's actually in continuous tension with it. With the development of circulation, conditions arise under which the alienation of commodities becomes separated by an interval of time from their realization of their prices. Here Marx begins to talk about the process where there's no actual utilization of money at all. This is the form money takes when its function as a means of payment is separated from the means of purchase. In this scenario, the M in the circuit CMC is credit money, an IOU of imaginary money which is paid at a later date. In this sense, someone buys a commodity before they pay for it, or pays for it with a symbol of future money. If we think of this in today's world, we buy things with credit cards and pay back the money later on. In a materialist sense, however, we can view how this method of credit payment became a historical process. Many types of production and concrete labours depend on the ability to buy now and pay at a later date. Farming is one example. The growing and harvesting of crops are crucial for society, yet they rely heavily on the seasons. But farmers need tools, supplies, machines, and workers all year round, so they must borrow to afford these things. And it's not until they harvest the crops and sell them that they can afford to pay it back. Marx now briefly talks about how debt itself can be circulated and used as a means of payment or liquidated. For example, person A owes person B £100, while person B owes C £100, yet C owes D £100. If their debts were to be confronted with one another, in effect, only one payment of £100 needs to be made between person A and person D. The seller turned his commodity into money in order thereby to satisfy some want. The hoarder did the same in order to keep his commodity in its money shape, and the debtor in order to be able to pay. If he did not pay, his goods would be sold by the sheriff. The value form of commodities, money, is therefore now the end and aim of a sale, and that owing to a social necessity springing out of the process of circulation itself. Marx dedicates many chapters to the role of credit and interest and its function within capitalism in volume 3 of Capital, so his comments here are quite brief, but they serve to highlight a few interesting points. Firstly, that even in pre-capitalist times, credit money was part of the class struggle. He notes, the class struggle in the ancient world, for instance, took the form mainly of contests between debtors and creditors, and ended in Rome with the ruin of the plebeian debtors who were replaced by slaves. Secondly, that the idea of credit money highlights the absolute contradiction between commodities and their value form of money. If the whole system functions solely as a way of circulating commodities and declares that commodities themselves are money, when it comes to the settlement and repayment of debts, commodities alone no longer settle it. Their use values become valueless, and money alone is declared the only commodity. Lastly, that the role of credit and debt isn't something someone just invented out of thin air, but it's a role that organically forms out of necessity around the social relations in a society that has a concept of value. As we saw in our example of farming, the creditor and debtor relationship becomes an important historical shift in exchange relations from CMC, commodities exchange for money, exchange for commodities, to MCM, money exchange for commodities, exchange for money, and its inevitable transformation into capitalism. It is only in the markets of the world that money acquires to the full extent the character of the commodity, whose bodily form is also the immediate social incarnation of human labour in the abstract. In this short section, Marx discusses money on an international level. On the world stage, money loses the local functions it has acquired, as a standard of prices, coins, and small change, and as a symbol of value. In Marx's time, money functioning on the world economic stage mainly took the form of gold directly, expressing the absolute social materialization of wealth to be exchanged between nations for the payment of trade and the settling of debts. As international payments change with fluctuating capital flows and trade between countries, then so states also require international reserves of gold, or hoards, to remain flexible.